This is an extract from the book The Age of Responsibility, CSR 2.0 and the New DNA of Business by Wayne Visser, read by the author. Part 2, Chapter 2, The Age of Greed. Gordon Gekko, the character in the Hollywood blockbuster Wall Street, said, "The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right, greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. Greed in all its forms, greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind." Case 1. Larry McDonald and Lehman Brothers. This vignette is a true story, preceded and adapted from Larry McDonald's book, A Colossal Failure of Common Sense, the incredible inside story of the collapse of Lehman Brothers. Larry McDonald was a child of the Greed is Good 80s, but, unlike me, he actually lived the dream and is still haunted by the nightmare that ensued. Looking back, there are several obvious pieces to the puzzle, factors that explain McDonald's unrelenting drive to become a high-stakes player on Wall Street. His father was obsessed with business, and plastics made him a stack of money, enough to start his own brokerage firm. That obsession took its toll on family life, and McDonald soon found himself in a broken home, living with his mother and four siblings on a housing estate, at the wrong end of what he called the urban version of Death Valley. Despite this, or more likely because of it, McDonald set his sights on escaping the mire of poverty. He now knew where he did not want to be. And thanks to his father's high-flying business career, he knew where he wanted to get to. "By the time I graduated from college in 1989, McDonald recalled, "I had learned enough about Wall Street to understand that that was the place I wanted to be, right out there in New York with the big dogs, playing in the major leagues of finance. The trouble was, my chances of getting in were zilch." Wall Street became McDonald's personal holy grail. He was smart enough to realize that he was still light years away, but he set himself a secret 5-year target to make it there. First, he tried to get into one of the brokerage houses in New England. Hundreds of rejection letters later, he changed his strategy. Midway through his second year, he was one of the top salesmen in the entire American Frozen Foods Northeast region. He began lying his way past office security guards and executive personal assistants, dressing up as a pizza delivery man, trying just about anything to get an audience with one of the branch managers. One day, McDonald's chutzpah, if that's what you would call it, paid off. But it wasn't the break he'd hoped for. "Kid," the manager told him, "I don't care what you sell for your first experience, but for Christ's sake, get out there and sell them something. Something rather than wasting my time." That was the clue, the key to breaking into the fortress of high finance. McDonald sprung into action and got a sales job, selling pork around the Cape and southeastern Massachusetts. McDonald, and when he passed his exam, he would work for them, joining their fat, chain-smoking salesmen that would say anything to their victims. McDonald made the Faustian bargain and passed the exam, but managed to get a job with Merrill Lynch in Philadelphia instead, thereby avoiding the bucket shop, which he regarded distastefully as, and I quote, "the totally unacceptable face of capitalism." McDonald worked hard, began specializing in convertible bonds, made good money, and plotted his next move. While he was still scheming, he ran into an acquaintance in a bar who worked for IBM and was about to start up one of the Cape's first internet service providers. He convinced McDonald that pretty soon the dot-com boom would revolutionize everything. Financial trading would go online. Sensing a blockbuster opportunity, McDonald hatched a plot with an old friend to start up convertbond.com, which they launched in 1997. Pretty soon, the Wall Street Journal, and CNBC television were featuring stories about them, and the business took off. Despite running a seat-of-the-pants operation out of a small office above a strip mall, with 250,000 hits a day, their opinions on newly issued bonds started to hold considerable sway in the market. McDonald had caught the wave of the future, and it hadn't gone unnoticed by the big boys. In the autumn of 1999, Morgan Stanley made an offer to take over ConvertBond.com. Suddenly, McDonald's was a 33-year-old millionaire and worked in Morgan Stanley's Stamford office, another step closer to Wall Street. The dot-com bubble burst soon afterwards, so McDonald had got out just in time, and more drama was to come. In 2001, McDonald's was in the thick of convertible bonds action as First Pacific Gas and Electric filed for bankruptcy, then 9/11 happened, and finally the Enron debacle broke. He watched, mesmerized, as Enron, saddled with $65 billion in unpayable debt, spiraled to their death at the hands of the financial markets, with their share price plummeting from just $90 to a few cents within a few months. In the months that followed, a spate of bankruptcies rocked the world, all of companies that issued convertible bonds: Global Crossing, Quest, NTL, Adelphia Communications, and WorldCom. McDonald had a front row seat of the whole financial operatic tragedy. Alan Greenspan's response was to cut interest rates from 6% in December 2000 to 1% by July 2003. Thus began one of the greatest consumer borrowing bonanzas since the 1920s, reflected McDonald. This was the starting point of America living in a false economy, because all of this free money was in defiance of the natural laws of the universe. His father agreed. "Here we go again," he warned, "straight back to the edge of the cliff." But one person's poison is another person's potion. Wall Street had just invented securitization, turning mortgage debts into tangible, tradable entities. "What a pure stroke of genius," said McDonald. Hardly anyone noticed the minor flaws that would, in time, bankrupt half the world. As 2004 arrived, the flame of McDonald's ambitions burned strong as ever. "I still wanted a seat at Wall Street's top table, right up there in the major leagues." Fortunately, he knew someone who worked for Lehman's, that pinnacle of his ambition that had survived and thrived for over 150 years. The friend encouraged McDonald to apply for a position, and after a series of grueling interviews, he stepped into the lion's den. Admittedly, it had taken 16 years rather than the 5 he had hoped for, but here he was, into the hierarchy alongside some of Wall Street's smartest guys. For the next few years, McDonald's dream became an intoxicating, head-spinning reality. He would wake at 4 a.m. and be at his desk before 6, working in a chilled, oxygen-fed trading office, taking no lunch and leaving more than 12 hours later. It was tiring, but he found it exhilarating. "We were in the presence of gods, the new masters of the universe, a breed of financial daredevils who conjured Lehman's billion-dollar profits out of one of the most complex markets ever to show its head above the Wall Street's ramparts. This was the age of the derivative, the Wall Street neutron that provided atomic power to one of the most reckless housing booms in all of history," he reflected. McDonald had his doubts about the subprime bonanza, but he knew his limits. "I didn't dare to mention even a semblance of doubt, not to anyone," he said. "That would have been tantamount to high treason, as if the President of the United States had invited Osama bin Laden to Camp David for the weekend." Besides, McDonald's was benefiting big time. Wall Street bonuses were 250% bigger than the average salary for all non-financial jobs in the city. And since 2003, thanks to derivatives, their total compensation had increased nearly 50%. That was, in retrospect, on the high side, recalled McDonald's, but that's what it was all about: record leverage, record bonuses. It later turned out that McDonald was not alone in his suspicions about the market's greed-fueled behavior. On 6th of June 2006, all the staff in his unit in Lehman's were called into a meeting and addressed by one of the newly promoted managing directors. He said the US real estate market was, and I quote, pumped up like an athlete on steroids, rippling with a set of muscles that did not naturally belong there. It was based on money that was not real money, home prices that were not real prices, and mortgages that were not grounded in any definition of reality. The presentation went down like a lead balloon among the traders. One retorted, "Have you missed the fact that this bull market is exploding?" The prevailing opinion of eternal sunshine was hardly surprising. True, US consumer and corporate debt was stacking up, $1 trillion in 2000 and $2.7 trillion by 2005. But Wall Street was still making shiploads of money and everyone was bullish. Even Time magazine declared that, and I quote, "The world economy is on track to enjoy another bumper year in 2006, as this twin American-Chinese engine continues to power ahead." "The outlook is basically for another Goldilocks kind of year," agreed Lara D. Tyson, then Dean of London Business School. But some, including McDonald's and a few bears at Lehman's, had spotted the cracks in the shining edifice of global financial markets. Despite these early warning signals, the tide and optimism of greed continued to sweep through Lehman's, America, and the world, and McDonald's was riding high, making more than a tidy golden nest egg in the process. By the time the spring tide had turned into an incontestable financial tsunami, it was too late. Too late for Lehman's and too late for McDonald. When 158-year-old Lehman Brothers filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy on 15 September 2008, owing $660 billion. It took a good portion of Wall Street, Main Street, and the world economy down with it. McDonald's still lives just a few city blocks from the old Lehman Brothers headquarters at 745 7th Avenue. Each time he walks past, he is overcome with mixed emotions, mainly nostalgia, edged by a lingering anger, and still plagued by unanswerable questions. "I stand and stare upward, sorrowful beyond reason," McDonald confesses, and trapped by the twin words of those possessed of flawless hindsight, "if only." An unhealthy appetite. If only, indeed. I began this chapter with Larry McDonald's true story because I think it tells us something about the age of greed. This was an age that began with the first financial derivatives when they were traded on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange in 1972 and peaked, we hope, with Lehman's collapse in 2008. It was a time when greed is good and bigger is better were the dual mottos that seemed to underpin the American dream. The invisible hand of the market went largely unquestioned. Incentives, like Wall Street profits and traders' bonuses, were perverse, leading not only to unbelievable wealth in the hands of a few speculators, but ultimately to global financial catastrophe. McDonald's story, I believe, gets to the heart of the nature of greed. The word greed, from the Old English, has etymological roots that relate to hunger and eagerness. This is similar to the older word avarice, coming from Old French and Latin, meaning to crave or long for. These are characteristics that McDonald had in spades. The Greek word for greed literally means money-loving. Also, that has a familiar ring in McDonald's story. The trouble is that capitalism in general, and the American dream in particular, has tended to interpret this as a healthy trait. McDonald didn't believe he was doing anything wrong or being unethical. He was playing the game extremely well until it all collapsed like a house of cards, and being rewarded handsomely for his aptitude, no questions asked. No doubt McDonald would have been unfamiliar, or at least uncomfortable, with the German root for the word greed, which means to have a sickness or disease. And yet I believe this comes closer to the real essence of greed, for it acts like a cancer in society, like a cell in the body which becomes so selfish that that it ultimately destroys its host. As with cancer, however, the enabling environment is as important as the greedy cell itself. As implied by the title of my book, Beyond Reasonable Greed, a certain measure of selfishness is natural, but it needs to be moderated by norms, rules, and cultural taboos that keep its destructive tendencies in check. It is worth reminding ourselves what the consequences of those destructive tendencies can mean in the lives of millions of ordinary people. The financial cost of cleaning up after the global financial crisis, which ultimately gets translated into a tax burden on the public, was estimated by the International Monetary Fund in August 2009 at £7.1 trillion, or $11 trillion, enough to finance a £1,779 or $2,748 handout for every man, woman, and child on the planet. This gargantuan sum includes capital injections pumped into banks in order to prevent them from collapsing, the cost of soaking up so-called toxic assets, guarantees over debt, and liquidity support from central banks. And then there is the human cost of unemployment. In January 2010, the International Labour Organization released figures showing that the global unemployment rate for 2009 was 6.6%, or 212 million people, an increase of almost 34 million over 2007. In the US alone, over 100,000 businesses filed for bankruptcy in 2008 and 2009. At the same time, the World Bank estimated that the financial crisis left an additional 50 million people around the world in extreme poverty in 2009, and some 64 million in 2010, relative to a no-crisis scenario, principally in sub-Saharan Africa and Eastern and Southeastern Asia. We should all be outraged by the dire human and economic fallout from banking greed, and indeed many are. But it is important to remember that the age of greed was not something out there. It was not the preserve of a few rogue traders, or even thoughtful and somewhat concerned traders like McDonald. We were all caught up in its web. Our global financial implosion was, and is, a multi-level phenomenon, incorporating executive greed, banking greed, financial market greed, corporate greed, and ultimately, greed embedded in the capitalist system. Executive greed. The most convenient explanation for the financial crisis is to point a finger at the greed and irresponsibility of a few individual executives, like Lehman Brothers, Richard or Dick Fuld. It is an argument with significant weight and popular appeal, as we always want a scapegoat to assuage our pain. We saw it all before with Enron. In 2000, Enron was the seventh largest company in America, with revenues of $111 billion and over 20,000 staff. When the company collapsed in 2001, due to various fraudulent accounting activities, the average severance payment was $45,000, while executives received bonuses of $55 million in the company's last year. Employees lost $1.2 billion in pensions and retirees lost $2 billion, but executives cashed in $116 million in stocks. The dissolution of the accounting firm Anderson also resulted in the loss of 85,000 jobs. It is no surprise that Enron's executives took the fall and that not a single public tear was shed as a result. Jeffrey Skilling, the former CEO, pleaded not guilty but was found culpable on 19 counts of fraud, conspiracy, insider trading, and lying to auditors. He was sentenced to more than 24 years in prison and a fine of $45 million. Kenneth Lay, Enron's former chairman, was found guilty on 10 counts, but died of heart failure before sentence was passed. And Andrew Fastow, the former chief financial officer, was sentenced to 6 years in prison for his part in the cover-up. So we had our scapegoats. They got what they deserved. And as far as Wall Street was concerned, they could go back to business greed as usual. By the end of 2007, a similar pattern was already emerging, in large part due to the greed-hyped activities of Lehman Brothers and other financial institutions. with the financial crisis writing already writ large on the wall, including on Wall Street, Fold and Lehman's president, Joseph Gregory, paid themselves stock bonuses of $35 million and $29 million, respectively. Fold continued to live in his enormous Greenwich mansion of over 9,000 square feet, valued at $10 million, and he certainly had no intention of giving up his four other homes and his art collection, valued at $200 million. Taken on their own, these examples of executive excess are outrageous enough, but the extent of creeping executive greed comes into even sharper focus when we look at trends in relative pay. In 1965, American CEOs in major companies earned 24 times more than a typical worker, but that ratio steadily grew to 35 in 1978 and 71 in 1989. By the year 2000, it had hit 298 times, and despite falling to 143 in 2002, after the post-Enron stock market slump, it bounced back again and continued rising through the 2000s. According to Fair Economy, in 2007, despite the looming economic recession, CEO pay of the largest 500 companies in America, the S&P 500, averaged $10.5 million, 344 times the pay of a typical American worker, and 866 times as much as the minimum wage of employees. The same year, the top 50 hedge and private equity fund managers earned an average of $588 million, according to Alpha magazine, more than 19,000 times as much as average worker pay. And in 2008, while the financial crisis was beginning to bite for ordinary citizens, average CEO pay went up to $10.9 million, while CEO perks averaged at $365,000, nearly 10 times the median salary of a full-time worker. It is easy to go cross-eyed or brain-fried when confronted by a barrage of numbers like that. But there is one particular number that shocked me so much the first time I read it in 1997 that I have never forgotten it. I believe I read it in Anita Roddick's book, Body and Soul, where she claimed that it would take one Haitian worker producing Disney clothes and dolls 166 years to earn as much as Disney's then president, Michael Eisner, earned in one day. As I later wrote, rather than spreading around wealth for the common good, it seems to me that Adam Smith's invisible hand has a compulsive habit of feeding itself. Banking greed. Horrific as these trends in executive greed are, and they certainly represent a responsibility train wreck, I do not believe that the global financial crisis can be adequately explained by so-called bad apples, as the media like to characterize these now disgraced captains of industry. In addition to those leaders who were driven by personal greed, the subprime loans crisis was also a story of institutional greed, sparked and fueled by deregulation of the financial sector since the 1980s. In particular, we can point to a number of poor US policy decisions that were to have disastrous consequences. The first was President Bill Clinton's campaign promise to increase home ownership in poor and minority communities, a noble cause to be sure, but one which put pressure on the banks to make riskier loans, 2 million of them between 1993 and 1999. The folly of this policy, while obvious in retrospect, did not pose any immediate concerns, as the housing market was strong and prices continued to rise. Over the same period, Clinton was coming under increasing pressure by the banking lobby to repeal the Glass-Steagall Act of 1933, a piece of post-Wall Street crash legislation that prevented commercial banks from merging with investment banks. The law was specifically put in place to prevent another global financial crisis and ensuing depression. At first, Clinton resisted, but the banks were relentless. In 1998, one of the banks, Citicorp, decided to flout the law, announcing a $70 billion merger with Travelers Insurance. Clinton tried to block it but failed in the Senate, despite the fact that the merger was technically illegal. A year later, Clinton bowed to rising pressure and repealed the Glass-Steagall Act. This single action proved to be the butterfly effect that would bring the world financial system to its knees. With the stroke of a pen and bullied by the greed of the banks, Clinton had given permission for speculative financial traders to start gambling with the hard-earned deposits of ordinary Americans and others. Soon all manner of financial instruments exploded onto the markets. From collateralized debt obligations and collateralized loan obligations to commercial mortgage-backed securities and credit default swaps. For a year or two, it seemed like the party may have ended before it had begun, as Wall Street contemplated the bankruptcy of Enron and others, which had issued convertible bonds. The 9/11 tragedy and dot-com crash was happening around the same time, and some measure of caution did return to the markets, but not for long. Alan Greenspan's slashing of interest rates to 1% was, like Clinton's repeal of Glass-Steagall, a butterfly effect that would cause a financial typhoon. Suddenly, not only was the housing market growing, but money was almost free. And with the help of all those newly invented financial voodoo instruments, the subprime party really got going. It all seems surreal in retrospect, looking back as we now do from our economic hospital beds in 2010. How was it that preposterous loans like the Ninja Mortgage, the so-called no income, no jobs and no assets that were required to qualify, how was that ever allowed to exist? It didn't matter that you were poor or had no collateral. Not only would you get a mortgage, the broker would pay you 10% more than you needed to buy the house. The initial interest rate, what the brokers called the teaser rate, would be next to nothing, then increase 5 or 10-fold in the years to come. The infallible logic behind this, if that isn't an oxymoron, was that housing market prices would continue to rise steadily, and everyone would be a winner. If you couldn't pay your monthly installments, no problem. Just sell the house, pay off the mortgage, and you would still have some money left over in your pocket. The result was that, according to the Mortgage Bankers Association, the number of subprime loans offered to borrowers with below-average credit ratings increased nearly 15 times between 1998 and 2007, from round about 421,000 to 6.2 million. Meanwhile, the banks were in a feeding frenzy, leveraging themselves to the hilt so that they could make obscene profits from the market boom. To give you some idea, a leverage of 10 times, where a company has debts of 10 times its actual value, was considered very high. But by the time Lehman Brothers hit the iceberg, it was well on its way to being leveraged to 44 times its value, owing more than $700 billion. The face of banking greed was finally unmasked. Financial market greed. Many global financial crisis analysts would stop there, satisfied that the combination of executive greed and banking greed provides sufficient explanation for the global responsibility crisis. And they certainly do represent the most obvious failures that caused the mother of all meltdowns. However, I do not believe that these two factors alone tell the whole story. To understand banking greed, we need to look at the nature of the financial markets as a whole, how they are designed, how they operate, and the behaviors they incentivize. In order to understand what greed is good really means, in terms of hard numbers, we must wrap our heads around the concept of financial derivatives. McDonald referred to derivatives as the Wall Street neutron, but what are they? Put simply, they are speculative bets on changes in various market indicators, like currencies and interest rates, with the supposed effect of reducing overall risk. By the turn of the century, some 3 decades after their introduction, these esoteric financial instruments were growing at around 25% per year. Today, according to the Bank for International Settlements, the derivatives market is worth over 1,000 trillion, that's a quadrillion with 15 zeros, dollars. Why this is so significant is that most of this trade is not happening in the real economy, but rather in a parallel casino economy. Take trade in currencies, for example. In 1998, when new economists like Hazel Henderson were starting to take note of these trends, around 1.5 trillion, that's 12 zeros, in currency was traded daily on the global markets, up 45% from 1994. But only 2.5% was linked to real economy transactions such as trade, tourism, loans, or genuine investments on stock markets. The other 97.5%, up from 20% in the 1970s, was pure speculation, a gambling economy in which financial traders were making eye-popping sums of money without actually contributing anything tangible to the products and services that give us quality of life. This unflattering characterization of financial markets is not one that is only applied by outside critics of Wall Street. Referring to one of the more modern varieties of derivatives, the credit default swap, McDonald recalled that, and I quote, "In the merry month of May 2006, Wall Street took hold of this gambling concept and decided to transform itself into something between a Las Vegas casino and an off-track betting parlor." Early in 2006, there were $26 trillion of credit default swaps. By the beginning of 2008, it was $70 trillion, with just 17 banks carrying that risk. And that was besides the $15 to $18 trillion in other derivatives and fancy instruments, an alphabet soup of CDOs, RMBSs, CMBSs, CLOs, and ABSs. This was all well and good when it was just a high-stakes game for rich kids to play. But as we have seen with the repeal of the Glass-Steagall Act and the introduction of the Financial Services Modernization Act in 1999, the greed-infused, short-term obsessed gambling habits of Wall Street traders can have, and have had, very real and devastating effects on the very real economies and very real people of the world. Even today, in the aftermath of the financial crisis, very few of these financial market agents have taken responsibility or been made accountable. Speculators may do no harm as bubbles on a steady stream of enterprise, but the position is serious when enterprise becomes the bubble on a whirlpool of speculation. When the capital development of a country becomes a byproduct of the activities of a casino, the job is likely to be ill done. Well, ill done it has been, woefully ill done. No wonder billionaire investor Warren Buffett first described derivatives as weeds priced as flowers, and later as financial weapons of mass destruction. If Keynes were here today, standing with us on financial ground zero, and gazing at the post-apocalyptic debris of our once gleaming citadels of commerce, he might quite justifiably shake his head and mutter, "I told you so." Corporate greed. Even financial market greed may not be the ultimate cause of our woes. I'm not quite so uncharitable as Howard Scott, who says the definition of a criminal is a person with predatory instincts who has not sufficient capital to form a corporation. But could it be that unbridled greed is, by design, the unavoidable outcome of corporate institutions? We often forget that when corporations were originally introduced in America in the mid-1800s, it was with the explicit purpose of serving the public good. This was enshrined in a charter with liable shareholders. Only later did the nature of the corporation change when the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that the corporation should have the same rights as individuals, thus making it a legal person. The problem today, according to critics, is that the corporation is a person with no moral conscience and an exclusive focus on the benefits of shareholders. This results in a pattern of social costs imposed by business in exchange for private gains for its executives and owners. In his controversial yet highly influential book and documentary, The Corporation, Canadian legal academic Joel Bacon suggests that corporations are, by their legal constitution, pathological in nature. He says, "The corporation has a legally defined mandate to relentlessly pursue, without exception, its own self-interest, regardless of the often harmful consequences it might cause to others. Lying, stealing, and killing are not rare aberrations, but the duty of the corporation when it serves the interests of its shareholders to do so." This, according to Bacon, means that corporations have all the characteristics of a psychopath as defined by the World Health Organization. Well, not everyone, even among those concerned about business responsibility, would go quite this far in their diagnosis. But there is certainly little doubt that the inbuilt greed of the modern corporation does exist. David Corton, author of When Corporations Rule the World, is among the many critics that remind us of the dangerous power of business, a world in which more than half of the top 100 economies are in fact multinational corporations. With such awesome power comes huge responsibility. Yet left to their own devices, says Corton, many corporations are cost externalization machines. They will naturally and obsessively try to avoid paying for any negative human, community, or environmental costs that they impose on society. Corton believes the problem is even more fundamental than the corporations themselves. Talking to me in 2008, he reflected as follows. "If I were to write the book now, I would probably put the title When Corporations Rule the World with a slash through corporations and a little carrot pointing to money. It's actually when money rules the world. This has become so much more obvious, so much stronger, and so much more disruptive, as we've seen the rampant speculation in the financial markets. That very structure drives a predatory dynamic in the corporate system that you really can't do very much about at the level of the individual corporation. You can do a little tinkering around the edges, but those are pretty limited relative to the depth of changes that we need to navigate." A personal odyssey into greed. Having shared these different perspectives on the greed-related causes of the financial crisis, I should admit that my views on business and greed are strongly shaped by my own particular intellectual journey over the past 20 years. Like MacDonald, I grew up in the greed is good 80s. That was even what we called it when I was studying for my honours degree in business science. Admittedly, at the time, I didn't really understand what it meant, or at least not in technical financial terms. I knew that junk bonds, derivatives, and mergers and acquisitions were all the rage, and of course I had seen Oliver Stone's iconic masterpiece, Wall Street. I had even heard of the Black Monday, the infamous stock market crash of 19 October 1987, when the Dow Jones Industrial Average lost 22% in a single day. But I didn't really know the scale of greed that was in full swing by the time I graduated in 1991. I suppose I felt it more indirectly as the inevitable backdrop to my personal mission at the time, which was to bring about a new paradigm in business, one which questioned three fundamental beliefs: that profit is the primary purpose of companies, that competition is the most effective mode of operation, and that management is a rational undertaking. It didn't take long, 18 months to be exact, for that personal mission to become deeply frustrated as I entered the chew-em-up and spit-em-out burnout track of the international management consulting world, working for Capgemini as a strategy analyst. To be fair, it was a remarkably steep learning curve, and Gemini had some incredibly progressive ideas about business transformation. But in the end, we were in the business of making money for ourselves and our clients, and therein lay the rub. I just couldn't shake the nagging belief that life and work are not just about the money. Sure, we were transforming companies or re-engineering them, to use the parlance of the day. But to what end? Yes, they came out the other side lean and mean, but at what cost? The truth was that I just couldn't get excited about the money. So what if I helped make a company more profitable, or more to the point, helped to make their directors and shareholders richer? What about all the so-called collateral damage, the unfortunate people who were often let go thanks to our quest for efficiency and shareholder returns? And who were these shareholders anyway? As far as I could tell, many were what are increasingly known as share flippers, traders who are in it for a quick buck, who buy and sell shares without the least concern for the long-term prospects of the company, let alone its people or its environmental impacts. Discovering institutionalized greed. In 1995, I quit the rat race to do a master's in human ecology at Edinburgh University in Scotland. That proved to be a pivotal decision because it led me deeper into understanding the nature and extent of greed in business. The course director, Alistair McIntosh, was and is a fiery, red-bearded Scot with an MBA in finance who taught us to question the colossus edifices of power, especially multinational companies. McIntosh was just the catalyst I needed to question business as usual, drawing as he did from his own experience as an activist. For instance, he was a key figure in the campaign to oust the English landlord of the Island of Egg and to indefinitely stall Lafarge's plans to build a super quarry on the island. Both inspiring stories are written up in McIntosh's book called Soil and Soul. Partly as a result of McIntosh's influence, when I had to choose a topic for an essay assignment on human ecology, I decided to look at the practice of usury, the charging of interest on loans. This practice has been condemned by philosophical and religious traditions for more than 4,000 years. My research on usury confirmed that issues of ethics in business go way back in history, and likewise that greed is as ancient as the hominid caves of Sterkfontein in South Africa. But it also unveiled a surprising symptom of the greed sickness, namely the bizarre way that the modern banking system is constructed, in particular the method of fractional reserve banking. Fractional reserve banking allows private banks to create loans equivalent to about 7 times the amount of actual money, or assets like gold, that they hold in reserve. It seemed crazy to me then, and still does now, that private profit-making organizations, and banks are or were clearly among the most private and the most profitable, are able to create money out of thin air and then just make more money by charging interest on these loans that they conjured into existence from the financial ether. By contrast, I was mightily intrigued by radical alternatives, such as the creation of local currencies, especially the LETS, or local exchange trading system, which has now been taken up by the emerging transition towns movement, as well as Islamic equity-based banking. These have inbuilt checks and balances against greed. LETS was first established by Michael Linton in 1983, when his rural community in British Columbia in Canada was devastated by an economic recession. The system allows members to trade both goods and services using a combination of conventional dollars and community-created credits called green dollars. While members' balances are stored in a central computer program, there is no interest and no speculation in the LETS system. Islamic banking is quite different, but tackles greed in its own way. It is centered around financial equity-based approaches. Most notably, a joint venture between the bank and a partner, with both contributing to the capital of the project and sharing the profit or loss. Or the practice in which the capital for an investment is provided by the bank in return for a predetermined share of the profit or loss of the business undertaking. The claimed advantages of Islamic banking as an approach to finance are that it results in more just and equitable distribution of resources, as well as less volatile business cycles and more responsible and profitable lending due to closer bank-client relationships. Remember, the banker shares losses as well as profits. With my interest piqued, I chose my dissertation topic as a human and ecological critique of the UK financial system. This was when I finally got to grips with what greed is good really meant, in terms of hard numbers. In particular, I discovered the explosive financial derivatives trend that I have already discussed. An insane economy. This brave new world of global finance made a big impression on me, and after finishing my master's, I co-founded the South African New Economics Foundation, with a lofty aim of promoting a socially just and environmentally sustainable economy. If we can't change the rules of the game, I reasoned, how on earth can we expect the players, be they companies, managers, or citizens, to behave differently? I still think that. This wasn't so much trailblazing as hanging on to the comet tails of others ahead of me, most notably those involved in setting up the Other Economic Summit, or TOES, in 1984. This later became the hugely influential London-based think tank called the New Economics Foundation. As I searched in vain for a more sane agenda, the more I looked, the more it seemed to me that the so-called triumph of capitalism was in reality a disaster waiting to happen. The systemic risk of the casino economy was like a creaking San Andreas fault through the heart of Western and increasingly global capitalism. My concern about these issues was in no way due to my prophetic powers. I was only reflecting already widely held beliefs among those in the New Economics movement. In retrospect, I'm not sure how many of us really believed that the global financial meltdown would ever happen. It was one of those, taken to its logical conclusion, apocryphal warnings that we whispered smugly under our breaths, rather than shouting it from the rooftops. After all, no one wants to be known as a perpetual party-pooping doomsayer. How strange, therefore, that history has come so close to vindicating our timid cries in the desert. Through my work with the South African New Economics Foundation, I also came across the trends in executive compensation that I've already quoted. Now, I'm not one of those people that buy into the evil empire and Darth Vader stereotypes of business and CEOs. But surely there's something fundamentally flawed in a system that allows corporate and individual greed to spiral out of control to the extent that it has. Surely there is a moral limit to inequity that will, sooner or later, cause the patience of billions of so-called have-nots to run out, thereby starting a bloody revolution against the small number of those who have so much. Little did I know then, in 1997, that the greed treadmill would, in just a few short years, produce a cast of pantomime villains that even Oliver Stone would find incredible. The Belly of the Beast. From 1997 to 2001, I'd been getting up close and personal with many of the world's big brand multinationals. After establishing and heading up KPMG's Sustainability Services division in South Africa, the irony of working for one of the world's largest accounting firms, given what I knew about world finance, was not lost on me. Admittedly, I was not quite in the belly of the beast, but I was connected to the hand that fed, and sometimes stroked or prodded, the beast. And so when Enron collapsed and the bombshell exploded, I was an unwitting accessory and an agog spectator to the crime. Not directly, of course, but by virtue or vice of working for one of the big five and soon to be big four accounting firms. I was not financially affected, and yet somehow I felt I was straddling a fissure that ran right to the epicenter of the quake. Just how connected I was soon became clear. A series of hush-hush emergency meetings were held in the seminar rooms of KPMG, during which we were reassured by our leaders that we were safe, that this crisis had more to do with the lackluster US accounting practices than with the accounting profession per se, that our firm would never cover up for our clients in such a clandestine manner, and that although we could expect significantly more internal risk procedures from now on, other than that, it was full steam ahead, business as usual. Oh, and also that we would be merging with one of the firms in South Africa formerly known as Arthur Anderson, and we should be sensitive to the trauma they had endured. As it happened, when the Enron story broke, I was just putting the finishing touches to the manuscript of my first book, which was to be called Shapeshifting. Between its covers, and with the coaching of co-author and former South African mining magnate Clem Sunter, I had tried to capture what I had learned over the past 5 years about implementing sustainability in business. My argument was that companies needed to shapeshift from aggressive lion-like predators into more caring elephant-like creatures. It was a simplistic metaphor, but it worked. And now, just a few weeks before going to press, we had seen the death roar of one of the biggest cats of them all, an uber lion. To his credit, Clem Sunter convinced me, kicking and screaming, to change my beloved title to Beyond Reasonable Greed, and we revised and beefed up the content to drive home the message. Now, as I reread some of the observations we made, they seem to be more relevant today than they were in 2001. In the opening chapter, we said, "If the unfolding Enron saga is disclosing anything, it is that corporate governance is sometimes not worth the shredded paper it is written on. Bad magic has moved many companies into a state that is beyond reasonable greed. And the public have a good idea of the boundary between reasonable and obscene. These companies' boards probably comprise the normal spectrum of saints and sinners, but somehow they have allowed themselves to be collectively swept up along with the prevailing paradigm of success, which is purely financial, and that in turn has led to unreasonable behavior. In light of Enron's failure, this judgment may be overly kind, and more cases of dodgy accounting, inflated profits, and insider trading by the board may pop up in corporate America and corporate Europe. So we want to break the spell." Reforming the citadels of greed. As it turned out, many more cases did raise their ugly heads and shudder in the throes of death. In the book Beyond Reasonable Greed, we went on to say that a reformation in business along the same lines as the one precipitated by Martin Luther in 1517 was required. On the 31st of October of that year, he wrote an attack on the sale of indulgences in 95 theses, which he nailed to a church door. His basic point was that the church had become too interested in enriching itself at the expense of its true mission of providing spiritual leadership. It had lost the support of the population at large with its mercenary practices and obsession with grandeur and wealth. In exactly the same way, the modern corporate world has lost the confidence of the citizen in the street. The high priests of business, the board of directors, are perceived as just another example of a group of privileged people driven by unreasonable greed and feathering their own nests. The customers and shareholders come a poor second, and other stakeholders trail even further behind. The modern equivalent of indulgences is an astronomical salary, a large wad of share options, and a corporate jet. And the modern equivalent of the flowery and unintelligible prayers which the church used to recite in order to extract its indulgences from the peasantry is the purple prose and lofty sentiments expressed by companies in their mission statements, combined with a set of accounts that only the initiated can understand. I left KPMG shortly after the book was published to pursue a PhD in corporate social responsibility. It was time to question my own assumptions again. If anything, my interest in the question of greed had inflated rather than diminished. In the years that followed, first at Nottingham University and then at Cambridge University, I watched as America cobbled together the knee-jerk legislation of Sarbanes-Oxley. I listened as Judge Mervyn King, chairman of the extraordinarily progressive King Code on Corporate Governance, said, "Moses tried it and failed. Sarbanes and Oxley tried it, and they will fail. We cannot legislate against dishonesty." And all the while, I clung to my career in corporate sustainability and responsibility, believing that CSR's time had finally, really and truly, come. Accomplice to the crime. Today, in 2010, while the world is still reeling from global recession, I find myself compelled to ask many of the difficult questions that were raised earlier, and more besides. Was this, as MacDonald suggests in his book of the same name, simply a colossal failure of common sense? Was it the greed of so-called bad apples, like CEO Fold, or the bank's insatiable bonus-driven traders? Or was it the pervasive culture of greed in Wall Street as a whole? What about the greed of politicians and governments who were happy to benefit from growth on steroids? And what about Main Street? Wasn't the public, we the people, more than happy to greedily lap up those subprime loans? All this begs the larger question: is capitalism itself fundamentally flawed? Are we talking about endemic greed built into the free market system, a system which not only allowed but encouraged the fantasy of double-digit profit growth and an endless bull market? Will capitalism, with its short-term cost externalization, with its shareholder value focus, always tend towards greed at the expense of people and the planet? Will the scenario of overshoot and collapse that was computer modeled in the 1972 Limits to Growth report and reaffirmed in revisions 20 and 30 years later still come to pass? Has Karl Marx been vindicated in his critique that by design capitalism causes wealth and power to accumulate in fewer and fewer hands? Perhaps the trillion-dollar question for me is not whether capitalism per se acts like a cancer greed in the gene of society, but whether there are different types of capitalism, some of which are more benign than others. To date, the world has by and large been following the American model of shareholder-driven capitalism, and perhaps this is the version that is morally bankrupt and systemically flawed. Interestingly, a 2010 Pew poll of the American millennial generation, currently aged between 18 and 30, showed that just 43% still described capitalism as positive, while the same percentage now describes socialism as positive. Management guru Charles Handy seems to agree. Speaking to me in 2008, he confessed, "I've always had my doubts about shareholder capitalism because we keep talking about the shareholders as being owners of the business, but most of them haven't a clue what business they're in. They're basically punters with no particular interest in the horse that they're backing, as long as it wins." If we can learn one thing from the age of greed, it is that we have immense power to make change happen on a monumental scale and with lightning speed. Greed has proved to be a high-octane fuel in the rocket engine of globalization, but ultimately it was an economic missile without a moral guidance system. I'm under no illusions that the age of responsibility will vanquish greed. No doubt the selfish gene will continue to spark our evolution. And yet, if we are successful, the age of responsibility will provide capitalism with that much-needed moral compass, and systemic CSR will provide business with a mission-critical social purpose. First, however, we must consider what has been going on in parallel to the greed fest, because not everyone has been out to enrich only themselves.